1970, the Doors were suffering from a critical backlash, and Jim Morrison was facing felony charges for allegedly exposing himself in Miami. The Doors knew they had to make a musical statement strong enough to silence the doubters. Their new record, Morrison Hotel, was a return to stripped-down rock and roll. It avoided cosmic lyrics and jazz chords. Instead, it featured Bo Diddley rhythms, blues riffs, and lots of Morrison wailing. The cover photo was shot in the Skid Row Hotel in LA. The picture on the back was of a raunchy barroom. The message was clear. The Doors were dumping their pretenses. The band was concentrating on down and dirty rock. Some of the group's teeny bopper fans drifted away, but the Doors' hardcore audience liked what they heard. As Morrison Hotel was pushing its way up the charts, a book of Jim's poetry was released. The Lords and the New Creatures contained some of his verse from earlier days. As a Doors live record was released, Morrison dwelled on the pending Miami trial. He had cause to be worried.
Well, in the realm of art and theater, I do think that there should be complete freedom for the artist and performer. I'm not personally that convinced that nudity is always, you know, a necessary part of, you know, a play or a film, but the artist should feel free to use it if he feels like it.
Jim hoped the trial would be seen as a fight over freedom of expression. Instead, it turned into a pop culture carnival with crowds of teenage fans outside the building. Jim took the stand and said he didn't remember if he had actually exposed himself. He was too drunk to recall. The jury decided he had. Though they let him go on some counts, Morrison was convicted on the charge of indecent exposure. He was sentenced to 6 months of hard labor. His lawyers filed an appeal. Toward the end of the trial, Jimi Hendrix and Janis Joplin both died from abuse of drugs and booze. Morrison told some pals, "You're drinking with number three." Jim was depressed. The wear and tear of drinking and the threat of prison wounded his interest in music making. When they went in to make their next record, the Doors weren't very energetic. Their longtime producer, Paul Rothchild, got frustrated and quit. He said that the new tapes sounded like cocktail jazz. Rothchild's departure shook the Doors and forced them to work harder. Along with their engineer, Bruce Botnick, the band produced themselves. They enjoyed the new freedom. The result was L.A. Woman. It was eloquent in its description of apprehension and fear. Riders on the Storm was a dreamy tale of a serial killer that set the mood for the danger that was lurking ahead.
Riders on the Storm.
Late in December of 1970, Morrison cut a spoken word record of poetry. He showed up at the studio with a bottle and some friends. It was his birthday. For hours, he acted out his verse. Poetry was his first love. He was thrilled to finally have the opportunity to document it.
Awake. Shake dreams from your hair, my pretty child, my sweet one. Choose the day and choose the sign of your day, the day's divinity. First thing you see.
The Doors went off to Dallas and New Orleans to do shows. The first was fine. The second was awful. Drunk and drowsy, Morrison continuously smashed the mic stand into the stage, mumbling to himself. Densmore walked away from his drum set. The tour was canceled. The Doors were disintegrating. Jim Morrison was burned out and facing jail. The Doors had completed their obligation to Elektra Records. Morrison told his bandmates and friends that he and Pam were going to Paris to be alone. He wanted to spend time reading and writing. He had to get away from the trappings of rock.
I must find a place to hide, a place for me to hide.
L.A. Woman was released, and the song Love Her Madly was a hit. But Jim was enjoying the calm of French Bohemia and the freedom of anonymity. He told friends that, "People think of me as a rock star. I don't want to have anything to do with it." Back in LA, the Doors rehearsed without him. Even when his life was calm, Jim had to contend with alcoholism. After a couple of months of casual living, he slipped into his manic behavior once again. On July 2nd, 1971, in Paris, he went to see a Robert Mitchum movie and came back home complaining of chest pains. In the middle of that night, Pam found him dead in the bathtub. Only Pam and the doctor who signed the death certificate ever saw Jim Morrison's body. There was no autopsy. That prompted endless speculation. Did Morrison fake his death and disappear to get away from the courts and the spotlight? Did he buy heroin from a French dealer and OD? The rumors were wild and varied. He was already an international star. Death would make Jim Morrison a legend. With the death of Jim Morrison, the future of the Doors was uncertain. After much internal debate, Ray Manzarek, Robbie Krieger, and John Densmore decided to continue as a trio. They released two records after Morrison's death. Ray sang most of the songs. Neither album had much commercial success. They split up in 1973. In April of 74, Pamela Morrison was found dead from a heroin overdose in Los Angeles. The fans who believed Jim was still alive imagined she'd faked her death to join him. In 1978, the Doors created new music and sound collages to go along with the poetry tapes Jim recorded during his 27th birthday session in 1970. They were released by Elektra as An American Prayer. The legacy of the Doors continues. In 1979, Francis Ford Coppola used The End to set the mood of horror and devastation in his Vietnam opus, Apocalypse Now. Hollywood also churned out a big screen bio of the band's turbulent career, directed by Oliver Stone. Doors songs became fixtures on classic rock radio. In 1997, Ray, Robbie, and John went into a Los Angeles studio to put music to a newly discovered Morrison song called Orange County Sweet.
I'm very pleased with the music, very proud to have made the music with Densmore, Krieger, and Morrison. And those guys were great to work with, and I think we captured something, captured a moment in time, and captured also a timeless moment that'll perhaps live on into eternity.
Always a friend of mayhem, the Doors interfered with the status quo at every opportunity. There are many rock fans who believe that's exactly what the music should do. Entranced by the hostility of modern life, Jim Morrison used hysteria and literature as a springboard into salvation. During the fevered years from 1967 to 1970, the Doors made some of rock's most eternally disturbing music. For those who were there and were awake, the music of the Doors will always summon a passionate, dangerous era. For those too young to know how the songs felt when they were new, the Doors offer a glimpse into the emotional complexities of a time too often reduced to nostalgic simplicities. The Doors represent the 60s dichotomies of artistic ambition and rampant hedonism, flower power and anarchy, peace and violence, LSD and Jack Daniels. They were the antidote that contained the disease. They paid a terrible price for going into the unexplored regions, but they brought back incredible stories.
Love me one time, babe. I could not speak. Love me one time, baby. Yeah, my knees got weak. But love me two time, girl. Bless me. I'll
ate animals alive, he urinated on the Alamo. Ozzy Osbourne may not worship Satan, he may be Satan. Hear his story, then see him live in concert. Ozzy is live and loud, but the bat might be dead and decapitated. Tonight, it's all part of Behind the Music Bad Boys Week. And it all happens tonight starting at 9, 8 Central, only on VH1.